Four wrong ideas about God. Here's the first. person wrong, I think about that. And I'm like, God loves every person exactly the same way. You might be surprised, but I think most of us are saying this is true. But it's really not. God does not love every person the same way. If you'll just give it a moment of thought, you'll begin to see how unraised and what that kind of thinking is. And we often use the word love in many different ways. And in fact, we love it different ways. We love to different degrees. When you read that story, we love it different ways. We love to different degrees. Here's an example. I love my wife. But yesterday, by the grace of God, we celebrated 33 years of marriage. And apparently, the 4 years we did, I love her. I love my children. I love biscuits and gravy. Wait a minute. Did I stitch all those things together? I love my wife. I love my children. I love biscuits and gravy. But three different uses of the word love, all in the same sense, but married love is not the same type of love for children. Would y'all agree? It's different. Married love is different than the love I have for my children. And you can't even begin to put the love of biscuits and gravy in the same category. Love for food is not even in the same hemisphere of love for wife and love for children. But we use the word three different times in the same sentence. And from a biblical perspective, here's what we might say. God loves the world. See the difference? For God so loved the world that he lavishes his love on his children. Theologians use this word sovereign. They use that word to describe the love of God. And here's the thing. God shows love as he chooses to show love. He can do that because he's God. And since no one has a claim on God's love, no one can complain that God chooses to express his love towards someone else differently than he's demonstrated or showed to you. So it's not true that God loves everybody in the same way. It's just not true. He loves different. He loves the world. He lavishes his love on his children. Here's the second wrong idea about God's love. Some people mistakenly believe that God's love is about things and it's about his holiness. Just wipes it out. Unbelievers are notorious for thinking this way. Solomon. And many people have the idea that when they reach the gates of heaven, God's going to smile and say, come on in! And you never trust me. You never loved me. You never served me. But just come on in anyway. I wish that were true. Unfortunately, that view is completely false. See, whatever else may be said, this much is said. God's love is not some kind of divine, benevolent softness, because God cannot overlook sin. He can't. He will never contradict his own nature. Now, behind this wrong idea is a perverted view of love that says, if you love me, you'll accept anything I do. If you love me, you'll accept anything I do. By the way, that is such a perverted view of love. Love makes judgment calls. Love cares about right and wrong. That's why parents discipline their children. Because love makes judgment calls. In other words, that's why God disciplines his children. God's love is a holy love. It's built upon his holiness. And it cannot exist apart from it. Y'all agree? Y'all agree? Here's another wrong idea, number three. It's growing in popularity. Evangelical circles. Please read it. Say, this idea is really running rampant out on the street. This idea that I'm about to say is growing in popularity. Evangelical circles. Here it is. It's the idea that God's love means that everyone will one day be saved, regardless of what you believe. Universalism. I told you a few be spread to populate. Says, I love the Lord, or I'm a believer's going to heaven. But he just said, hell is going to be filled with religious people of all kinds. There'll be some Baptists in hell. Amen. There'll be some Presbyterians in hell. There'll be some Pentecostals in hell. There'll be some, you name the religion, but there'll be varieties of all kinds of religious people in hell. Died for the ungodly. Very rarely will anyone die for a righteous man.
Thank you.
love is greater than our sin. His love is both greater than our sin, in spite of us. Listen, God should love us, but he does. It's that truth that becomes the wonder of religious that God would actually love sworn enemies. Christ's love for man. And I'll just read it to you. This, when it comes down to this verse, you folks, I really want to lay my life down for. The text says that all of us would consider God worth loving folk. We just heard that from family members, people who really know that the circle is incredibly small. See, again, push comes to shove, when we get really honest, I'm not willing to take a bullet for very many folks. But then, not a small group of people that I just mentioned, and people in my circle of acquaintances, and they start talking about people that don't like me, and I've got to really break up liking them. They don't even know the equation. There are countless millions around the globe. We've all read stories, I've read stories, we've all read things where someone dies for free, when they die for a pardon, when a disaster happens, when a man trapped in a mine, death to a man's surprise, when one house is destroyed, when the wall caves in, and when one guy says, it's an awesome story, and we feel like we're almost on holy ground when we read about that kind of self-sacrifice because it's so real. But maybe you read about some kind of wartime situation, and it doesn't matter what's finishing or what perish. We read about maybe a Marine sergeant, for example. My dad was a Marine sergeant, he's a Marine, and maybe he's there, and they're down. Place they're all huddled around the fire trying to get warm. And all of a sudden, the grenade drops in the midst of the darkness. And the door of the gate, the sergeant realizes it's the same thing. And without thinking, he throws himself on the grenade. His blood passes in the process of saving his friends. Stories I just read, friends dying for friends, soldiers dying for other soldiers that they love. And we can understand that with people that probably, you know, if I were in that situation, I might do the same thing. But love goes so far beyond what I just described. And listen, we would never think of doing what God did. See, God did what we would never be. Small force person. God demonstrates and proves His own love for us is while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. While we were still sinners, that's when God said, I'm going to take a bullet for you. I'm going to die for you. See, when we read that verse, we like to emphasize Christ died for us. I think that's the moment. Here's where it should be emphasized. While we were still that's what needs to be brought out. The one miracle is not the question. I force it, but that is awesome. The wonder is that he would do it while we were still sinners, still ungodly, still powerless, still enemies of God. Listen, Jesus did not die for friends, he died for enemies. He died for people who crucified him. He died for people who hated him. He died for people who put thorns on his head. He died for people who whipped him, spit on him. He died for people who rejected him. Jesus didn't die for good people. He died for bad people. Jesus didn't die for sinners. He died for sinners, not for friends, but enemies. He did not die for people who loved him. He died for people who hated him. While we were still sinners, roaring God, burning His love, maybe even shaking an angry fist. separate us from God has been completely bridged. We who were once sinners have now become not only friends of God, but children of God. So much so that we've received the spirit of adoption that empowers us to cry out. Everything personal.